Ladies and gentlemen, it's now time to introduce to you our next speaker. Our next speaker has over 30 years of global experience and is currently a chairman at AccessCades, a leading integrated engineering service company and general partner at Your Nest Venture Capital Fund. He is an investor and a mentor to a number of startups and is deeply into research and development. Vivek holds 6 US patents, has published hundreds of articles and technical papers, and has also contributed to 2 books. He has taken a keen interest in entrepreneurship and leadership and has contributed valuable insights to Janagraha as a member of the advisory board. Janagraha's mission is to transform the quality of life in India's towns and cities. Here to speak about the startup lessons from the best, please put your hands together and join me in welcoming on the dais Mr. Vivek Mansingh.
Can they hear?
Yes, they can. All right. Let me see. So thank you for having me here, guys. First of all, very quick hands of how many people are already entrepreneurs here? Almost 50%. Wow. What are other 50%? Potential entrepreneurs? Potential entrepreneurs, please raise your hands. Okay, so another 30 odd percent. All right, that helps me take the talk to the right level of depth. So let me first of all introduce myself in a way that when I ask you something or when I give you a suggestion, your question should be, why am I suggesting so? Why am I thinking that way? And I'll give you that background. So first of all, my own experiences. I have been very, very fortunate to start my career with David Packard and Bill Hewlett. Then I have worked with David Packard, Bill Hewlett, Michael Dell, and John Chambers, and Steve Jobs. All these 5 people I have worked, I have learned a lot from them, and some of that I will share with you. This is when Steve Jobs came to the Apple the second time. Apple was in shambles, and at that time, I joined that team, and the first product we designed was iMac, which is Apple 2.0's first product. And from there, almost bankrupt company, we brought it to the most valuable company in the world. That is Steve Jobs, a second incarnation in Apple. And the message below says to Vivek and team, thanks so much for all your help. We couldn't have done without you. That is my prized possession, because you don't get Steve Jobs to write that kind of thing easily. As I was introduced, many, many patents, 2 books. The instrument on the top right-hand side is an instrument I developed when I was your age and licensed it to the worldwide and earned royalty on it for 17 years. After that, it becomes public. Bottom 2 pictures, I was in Who's Who of United States in 2000. After that, I moved back to India. And in 2016, I was given IT Man of the Year award for using technology for driving social change, not for making money, purely driving social change. 2 sites we started, we'll talk about it if you have any question on that. So I have had a lot of experience, 3 startups, 3 exits. I will talk about it at appropriate time as well. Last year, how many of you were here last year in the same event? Not here, but wherever the event was. So about 10%. I request all of you, last year I spoke on the 10 commandments for entrepreneurs. Please go and watch that talk. If you plan to be an entrepreneur or if you are an entrepreneur. The 10 commandments, I'm not going to go over all of them today. The talk is on YouTube. I request each one of you to watch and pay attention. It will save you enormous amount of work, and it may save your company as well, in the worst case. I will cover a couple of them, which I think are very, very important and worth repeating. So I will be talking about that. But please go and read and listen to this, the 10 Commandments on YouTube by me. Okay. So when I see, I must have seen in the last 3 years, at least 300 startups, and they are the selected ones that get to me. So these are selected ones that come to me. even after getting selected and making it to my level, I find that when I ask them question about competitive landscape, they are not ready. You cannot have a startup without knowing your competitive landscape. And 9 out of 10 times I hear, nobody really competes with me. Nobody is in my space. That is complete BS. Okay? So please spend a lot of time about knowing your competitive landscape. Otherwise, you are going to design products that nobody needs, or you will be too much behind, et cetera, et cetera. Very, very, very important. So all potential entrepreneurs and people who are entrepreneurs, understand your competitive landscape. People like Mahesh and all will tell you that if he is selling a Dell product, he would actually know an HP product better than he will know Dell product. But I don't find that entrepreneurs spend enough time to understand the competitive landscape. I go one step further, and I would like, at least in Indian setup, this is very, very valid, identify a role model company. Which company you want to be like. If you can't figure out the full strategy of the company, then that means you haven't thought through everything. So it could be a role model company in your industry, or it could be outside. But you should have a role model, actually, for personally you, as well as for company. But I always ask when the people meet me with a startup plan, who do you want to be like? And generally, there is blank. That is not a good answer. Without knowing the competitive landscape, you cannot articulate your differentiated value proposition to VCs. When I say differentiated value proposition, and then I ask you, show me the competitive landscape, or my own assistants go and do competitive landscape, your value proposition falls apart. So that is why I'm saying before you put a lot of work, make sure you do and understand competitive landscape very, very well. So point number one, I'm repeating from my last year's talk. Number two, you must have heard this term, leadership is lonely. My opinion, that doesn't apply to you if you have good mentors. Leadership is not lonely. If you do not have even one mentor who you can talk to about your critical decisions, you have a non-starter to begin with. I, at this stage, have multiple mentors who I can reach out to talk about anything. If you don't have one, find one. If you can't get a mentor, you are not fit to do a startup. You can't find one person who is willing to mentor you. You will have to convince hundreds of people in order for your startup to succeed. So please find a mentor. A mentor is not a friend. A mentor tells you what you do not want to hear. So you don't want a friend who just seconds you in everything that you are trying to do. You want someone who can challenge you and say, this is not right. This is not going to work. If you don't have a mentor who can do that, question yourself. Why don't you have it? Throughout my life, I have had mentors, and I have no problem finding. I'm sure you can find as well. Don't write to me. After last year's talk, so many people wrote to me that I want you to be my mentor. I don't want to be mentor to all of you. I'm saying you find a mentor who can help you in this journey, which is going to be very, 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 very tough. At least one mentor. You can have multiple mentors, by the way. But at least one mentor should have been there, done that, a startup. The startup is like going to Mount Everest or learning swimming. Somebody who has not done swimming cannot teach you how to swim by the theory of swimming. You will go right underwater. One person of one of your mentors have to be an entrepreneur. You can have multiple mentors. Maybe a sales champion can teach you sales. Maybe a technology architect from Dell or Cisco can teach you technology. No problem. But at least have one person who has been an entrepreneur. Successful or failed, I don't care. But at least one person should be an entrepreneur who has gone through the whole journey and who can guide you through this very, very difficult journey. Let's look at how startups succeed, right? A lot of research has been done on what are the top three criteria for startups to succeed. You know, number one is timing. What do you mean by timing, for example? Two things. Timing is two things. One is the timing of the startup, which means just what year it is. I tell you, I have done three startups. The worst in terms of value proposition did the best because it was 2000. 2000, everything was hunky-dory. You couldn't go wrong. Your startup got great valuation. So one is the time and the sort of year and what is going around in the world. You can't control that. That is not in your control, but it plays a huge role, I can tell you that. My most valuable startup went through serious trouble and had an exit to Philips, but it was a struggle, and the worst value we got, why? Because it was the year 2001, when no one wanted to invest. So the timing is from two perspectives. One, what time and what is going on around the world, in the startup world, in stock market, in economy, all of those play a very major role in your valuation and exit. That you need to understand. Now, this is not in your control, so don't wait for it. The second part of the timing is, are you too early or are you too late in doing your startup? So let me qualify. A number of startups came up who were doing internet-related startup. Internet penetration is not good enough, and they failed. A number of video-related startups came up. The internet bandwidth was not there, they failed. Same technology, same companies later became successful because internet penetration crossed a certain level. The bandwidth requirements, etc., became more loose. So make sure you pay attention to the timing. Being too early is bad, but being late is unforgivable. What do I mean by that? If you are doing a startup and you are the 10th startup in the same space, it's very, very hard for you to do anything. So that's why I said doing competitive landscape is very, very important. If you are a 10th startup, forget it. Unless there is a way for you to differentiate and do something different. So timing for your startup as well as global timing is very important. Team is number two criteria. This is from multiple research at Stanford and all. Number one is timing. Number two is team, which has to have diverse skill set. I see a lot of startups where technology person is very strong, but no sales. Or I see a salesperson very strong, but no technology, and so on. That does not work. Diverse skill set is very important in the team for you to have. And the third comes the idea and the business model. Now you will say, how is that possible? The startup starts with a business idea. Yes, it does. And that is important because that is your starting point. But idea and business models change over time. I do not know any startup that entered and exited with the same business model. Please understand this very, very important point. I do not know any startup that entered and exited with the same business model. They change, the products evolve, the business model evolves, so it will change. But you have to be strong on the top two. So these are the criteria for why startups succeed. Why startups fail then? Number one is no market need. 42% have designed a product that nobody needs really. That's why I'm saying do competitive analysis. The first slide I want to see from after knowing the background of the people who are doing the startup is, why are you doing this product? What is the competitive landscape? So 42%, there is no market need. Another 29% ran out of cash. Why? Because they could not raise money. Why could they not raise money? There was no value proposition. So 70% plus companies or startups fail because they don't really have a right product which has a strong differentiated value proposition. Pay attention to that. Now let's see what we can learn from some of these phenomenal people. So Steve Jobs, I don't need to introduce him, but the way I describe Steve Jobs is an amazing person who had imagination and capability to realize it through innovation and attention to detail. His ability to pay attention to detail was phenomenal. So is Michael Dell, by the way. But let's talk about Steve. That is his value. He was also a gifted person who said customers are not supposed to know what they need. He said, you need to know what customers need. That is an insight that Steve Jobs can have. Most other people actually do not have that insight. But that is his conviction, and that is what made him who he was. Let me give you an instance for that. This is an important lesson for you. During the iPhone design, Steve had selected the size of the phone, which would fit in a normal pocket. And he had said it should be this wide, this high, and this thick. He asked his team to develop that product. After months of work, the team developed a product which met that criteria, but it was a millimeter thicker than what Steve wanted. When that product was presented to Steve, the only working prototype that Steve had at that time of iPhone, Steve was not happy. He kept on walking and kept on discussing with the team that I'm not happy. And then he goes, and there is a fish tank, and he drops that only working prototype of that iPhone in the fish tank. And several bubbles come out. And he said, look, there is space in this. Go back to the drawing board. And they did go to the drawing board. They came back with the same spec, and rest is history. That is Steve Jobs. That is conviction. That is attention to detail. How many of you will actually stick to your product specification or product quality by that yard? Very hard to do. So please understand that that is why Steve Jobs became Steve Jobs. From your perspective, I can tell you, I see startups who have an idea. That idea they are taking forward for 3, 4, 5 years, but in this path, not much innovation is going on. So your idea in 5 years is obsolete, guys. What are you doing to make sure your innovation is sort of going along with your journey? I find the companies that can do these survive or do well. People who start with an idea and then just execute the idea for the next 5 years, by the time the idea comes out, is it obsolete? So it's very important for you to pay attention. I know there are a gazillion things going on. I know there's chaos going on. All that is going on, but you need to pause and see, are you still competitive? Are you still innovating? Remember, the value that you bring is only through innovation. Either it is business model, or it's a product, or it's a technology. So don't pause innovation. You start it, and then you forget it. Does not work. Michael Dell, look at this. Ideas are commodity. Execution of them is not. So we are too hung up on idea. We have found an idea that is so unique that nobody knows. That is BS number one. And then BS two, you don't evolve and invent, and so then that is a problem. And the third is you don't execute well. Michael Dell, he built purely on execution excellence. And execution excellence across the board in planning, in design, execution. The rigor word is very common in Dell. And rigor means following the intention of a process, not just process to just tick mark. So if you have a code review, for example, the code reviewer has to follow the intent of code review, not just check mark, I check this, I check that. That is of no value. So make sure you learn from Michael and execute well. Look at Jeff Bezos, very different business, very opposite to what he's saying about customers. He's saying, Jeff Bezos is saying, I constantly remind our employees to wake up every morning terrified, but not from our competition, but from our customers. He's saying, be customer-centric. John Chambers would probably say the same thing in a different way. And way backwards from customers need to know and build what they need. That is his style. Steve Jobs is saying opposite of that. He's saying you should know what the customers need. But then that's why he's Steve Jobs. The type of business Jeff started with is all customer-centric. So he's saying start from that end and build what they need, not what you think. So verify one end or the other. Make sure you play it correctly. Take John, for example, very important. He said the job of the CEO is these 4 points. Vision and strategy developed. John took the Cisco from $50 million company to $50 billion company. Not a joke to scale. For those of you who are in the stage where you are scaling your corporation or startup, it's very important to say, set vision and strategy, develop, recruit, retain, management, big part of the job, create the culture. If you ask John what is his number one job, he will talk about creating a culture. What does it mean for a startup? Startups don't pay attention to that, right? We are on a big mission. Let's just work together. What is the culture? Culture is to be as simple as that bad news first culture. I have a bad news first culture in my company. So nobody is afraid to share bad news. I'm slipping. Product is not going to be delivered on that date. Share the bad news first. In the meeting, as a CEO, when you start, you just say, hey guys, bad news first. Anyone wants to share anything? That sales has fallen through or it's not going to happen. Bad news first could be a great one. Customer focus could be another one. Innovation could be another one. Building trust could be another. Whatever culture you want. But there has to be something unique about your culture. I find that when I talk to startups and I say, okay, how is your working environment unique? They have nothing to say. You are working very hard, I know that, but every startup is working hard. What makes you unique? So create one simple one. I know you are not a Cisco or a Dell, so you don't need a complicated one. But what about bad news first? Simple, very, very powerful. Now, what do VCs look at? So a lot of you are finding company or are in a startup. Let me go through the list because that is what you need to address when you go and see a VC. So first of all, they look at you because who they invest in. So you are being X-rayed, let me tell you that, while you are talking. First 5 minutes, they are just X-raying you. How you walk, talk, can you sell, can you articulate, are you passionate? All of that is coming through who you are. So make sure you are representing who you are. Number two, we want to see integrity, passion, and commitment in you. That should come across very, very well. Open to being coached, very important for certain people. For us, your nest, it's very important that you are open to being coached. If you know it everything, then I don't think we want to fund that kind of company because we know that nobody can know everything. We want people to be coachable who can be helped. Experience, what experience you have, what domain expertise you have. Now, there are probably a lot of students here. They say we don't have either. We don't have experience. And there's examples of Yahoo and Google have been created pretty much out of college. No harm in that. After Google started, who did they hire as CEO? Very experienced guy. They filled the gap right away. The moment their technology got validated, they said, look, I know the technology, but now I need somebody who can actually scale the organization. So no harm as a student for you to start. Prove your model, do the pilot, whatever you need to do, but then figure out how do you fill this gap. Extremely important. So your domain expertise could be very, very much in demand, experience, but if you don't have either, make sure you fill that up somehow, because I'm going to ask you, you are going to design a product that is going to compete with Salesforce.com. Who is going to design this product? I ask this question, have you even looked at Salesforce.com? And they will say, no, we have just seen the spreadsheet or the spec sheet. Not good enough, guys. Skills. What skills, unique skills do you bring? Technology expert, marketing experts, sales, finance. Something has to be very, very good, or some gaps you are going to fill very shortly. Either way, it will work. Team with diverse skill set is very, very important. I find either the teams is by two technologists or by, you know, salesperson with not having enough technology, all that is not going to work. You will be challenged and you will have a lot of problems. So figure out how you are going to present a diverse team. It is acceptable answer to say, once I get this milestone, I'll hire this person or I'll bring this person and so on. It's okay. Number seven is a big problem in India as well. Your vision is not big enough. Your market address that you want to address is not big enough. My biggest concern in India is that, first of all, in 100 companies, probably 90 will fail, or 80 will fail. Then the other 15 or so will become $10 or $15 million companies and will just stay there. Serious concern we have. VCs don't want to fund those companies. I want to see $100 million or $50 million at least potential. Ideally, in the US Silicon Valley, if you go, they'll say, where is a $1 billion idea? Do you have potential to become a $1 billion company? Not in the next year, 5 years, 7 years. But in India, at least I want to see $100 million potential. And the companies are full of $10-15 million company. They go up to that point and they go sideways. There are not that many exits that happen in India, and you just operate there forever. It may be okay for founders, but VCs will not fund. So understand that. You have to address a big market. A strong differentiated value proposition. You need to convince me that your product is unique. If it's a global product, it has to be globally unique. Not easy for people to do, and they don't do enough time there. Validation means they should have some paying customers. Only then, only when you have some paying customers, and we make sure that they are not your friends or ex-colleagues and so on, because we don't count them. We want market information of validation. And then no BS. So when you come and say there's no competition, I am so unique, all that is not going to fly. Just say that, yes, we compete with them, but this is how we going to differentiate, this is how we are going to market our products, etc. So these are the 10 criteria that we see, and most VCs see that, plus minus. You need to address that before you hit a VC. Persevere. I think I was talking about it to someone earlier today. Most startups come face to face with death. Whether it's Yahoo, or it's Infosys, or it is Flipkart, your darling that you keep quoting everywhere. They all came close to death. To a level that, for example, Infosys, rest of the partners went to Mr. Murthy and said that we are done. Mr. Murthy said, I'll buy all your shares and I will continue. You guys can go. And Sudha Murthy's money, he borrowed. He said he will borrow and he'll buy all the shares, but he's going to continue in this journey. And slowly, other people came back and said, okay, we'll continue in this journey. Every startup I know, however successful it may be, comes close to death. How do you deal with that? It's very difficult. This is the time when you need a mentor. But number two is, do not open parachute until you have given everything you have. It's like skydiving. You guys have seen skydiving? If you open the parachute, the moment you started from the drop from the plane, there's no fun. The fun is when you open the parachute, when you're going to hit the ground. Assume that journey. Give it everything you have before you give up, because that is when startups turn around. Every single startup, read this, Intel almost was bankrupt. Any company that you can say, they all went almost near-death experience before they survived. If you are facing that, and I was talking to someone this morning about that, it's normal. Don't think you have screwed up something and that's why it is happening. No, that is normal. Be prepared for it, persevere through it, and then Hopefully you will come out. Of course, your mentors will guide you through this process. Have fun. Don't wait for fun to be there when you are bought or you are exiting, all that, because it may or may not happen, first of all. Also, it may take a long time. So don't wait. Enjoy this journey. Either you will learn something out of it or you will succeed, even if it fails. We value a lot of entrepreneurs who have failed startups for the right reasons, not stupid failures. But for the right reasons, if they failed, we value them actually, because they have learned a lot in this process. All right? So enjoy the journey, do your homework, do the competitive analysis, find a mentor, create a strong value proposition, and then start this journey and be prepared for near-death experience. And then if you have the right mentor, they will take you all the way through and you will have another Flipkart or another Google. Thank you so much. Thank you. I think I have some time for questions.
So we have time for two questions. So.
All right. Okay.
So can we have a mic being passed out there,
can
please?
Can you give the mic there?
Hello, sir. This is Nayan Mujadia, co-founder of WeCarry. We provide a door-to-door luggage pickup and drop-off. My question is, you talk about, you know, domain expertise related to that domain. So let's say if I don't have any of this, can I get that expertise through mentor?
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
That is why I meant. And as I said, you can have multiple mentors. So you don't have to have one mentor. One mentor can bring you that expertise. Another mentor who would have done a startup, they will say, I have been there. Think about it. Anybody goes to Mount Everest without a Sherpa?
No.
What is Sherpa there for? You are doing the mountain hiking. He's not. But he's there to say, no, this is normal. Keep going. Right? So you need that mentor who has been to Mount Everest, not the one who has been sitting in base camp and telling you, keep going.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, back there. There, back there.
Hello, sir. This is Jagjit. You explained the philosophy of different dignitaries like founders.
Can you speak a little louder? Yeah.
Now better?
Yes.
Yeah, so the philosophy of Steve Jobs is like work as if it is your last day. And at the same time, the Jeff Bezos, his philosophy is work as if it is your first day. So how different is this?
Yeah, I think that's a good question. I don't know if other people could figure that out. He's saying Steve Jobs' philosophy was work as if it is the last day. Jeff Bezos says that work as your first day. I think all they are saying is work passionately on whatever you are doing. My own advice to my children is work every day and change something that day. Small or big, doesn't matter. And work your tails off. I have met and worked with a lot of very, very successful people. You just saw five, but maybe I can give you 50. I can tell you one common factor. They all have worked very hard. Jeff Bezos is the only one who is bold enough to say, work hard and smart. Other people may say work smart and all that. It doesn't take you there. There are a lot of smart people in the world. You cannot be just smart. You have to be smart and work hard and being smart about how you work. So doesn't matter first day or last day, be passionate about what you do. These are all very passionate people. In my last year's talk, I have explained what passion does to you, how passion makes you a superhuman being. Passion is amazing. Passion is not just saying that I'm very passionate about it. Really, what passion does to people and how he converts a simple, normal human being into a superhuman being, that is the power of passion. It is explained in my talk last year.
Thank you, sir.
Okay? Yes. There are a lot of questions. I do not know how much time we have.
We are out of time, but we'll take this as our last question, okay, sir, and that will conclude our question and answer round.
Here. Just one last question.
Hi, myself Chakravarti. See, I have a question, sir. See, if you see past 15 years, the data, if we analyze currently, only aggregators has come forward and the brands has backward always. So for the current, you know, trend, what do you suggest? We need to build a brand or the aggregator sort of concept.
Yeah, I do not know what business you are in, but don't explain it. We are out of time.
Yeah.
I think pay attention to the three words that I have said: differentiated value proposition.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter you are building brand, you are building product, you are building aggregation. What is your differentiated value proposition? And if it's none, or I am cheaper by 10% or 20%, which I hear all the time, it's use waste of time. Okay, so remember these three words: differentiated value proposition. Value proposition is alone is not sufficient. All right, so irrespective of what business you are in, make sure you pay attention to differentiated value proposition. Remember that and you will never fail. Thank you guys a lot. Enjoy talking to you.
A bigger round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, and let's give it up for Mr. Vivek Mansingh. Sir, thank you so much for joining us out here at Demo Day 20.